Okay, finally we're ready to get started. Today we've got Scott Smith, and he's a senior consultant with LRS. And what we're going to talk about today is the idea of RESTful services with WCF. Duh, you can kind of see that. Scott's background is he came from California and has a degree in computer science from California. And then he righted things or wrong things by coming to Illinois in, what, 93, you said, and has been here ever since. And is currently working with LRS as a senior consultant. And one of his previous tasks, he worked on WCF RESTful services, which I think is a very appropriate topic to listen to. And I'm excited about it. So here's Scott.
Thanks. Thank you very much. I remember when I was trying to convince, I walked up to Alan a couple of months ago and said, hey, I've got something interesting, and I put a slideshow together for it because I think it might be interesting. And he's like, what is it? And I said, have you ever heard of RESTful services? And he had and was very excited. And he said, oh, yeah, WCF, and that's great. And so we only had a few minutes to talk, and this was the thing I drew up on the whiteboard. And for those of you who don't know, RESTful services are just very generalized services that can be consumed by anything out there that we know of. He pointed it out to me that Ruby is also something that can get to that. So if you write a service layer as a RESTful service, you could pretty much get to it from anything. You can write RESTful services in almost any language as well, although the ones that I was familiar with were written in Java for the most part and were put up on a Tomcat server. You write it in Eclipse. And I, as part of my proof of concept, I was working for this client. That's what I did. Well, I started to. I wrote the Hello World in Java, and then the big man upstairs said, no, we really do need to write this in .NET, which is fine, except I found out that .NET really likes SOAP better than it likes REST. And so I talked to the Java programmers that were going to be consuming this thing, and they said, we don't like SOAP. And I found out later on in my research that nobody except .NET likes SOAP. And 85% of the web-based community out there will not deal with SOAP, will have nothing to do with it. It's too verbose. It's just the overhead's too high, and you really can't do anything with it from their perspective. RESTful services are, and I probably should let you guys write this down. The one thing that really matters on this whole thing is the presentation can be found at. This presentation and all the software that I've got is on this Google site. So if you want to get to that later on, let me know. So this thing is in the way, isn't it? Great. So what is a RESTful service? A RESTful service was invented by Roy Fielding, who authored the HTTP 1.0 and 1.1 protocols, and it's called representational state transfer. And it's about as simple as you can get. You give a web address, and it will go, oh, and it'll throw you some data back. And then it goes back to sleep, and it's not running all the time. And it's great. It is really that's how Atom feeds and RSS feeds work. Amazon, all the major vendors, they use this kind of technology. And anybody in the world can hit it, and that's why they wrote it this way. And as time goes on and .NET may get marginalized, you may find yourself in a situation like I did where you've got a software development team where you've got some .NET people over here and you've got somebody else over here doing PHP or something. And they say, well, I need something in the middle because they both need the data and there's no sense writing two things. So that's what it's for. And what it usually deals with is JSON or plain old XML. Plain old XML and JSON are exactly the same except the delimiters look different. So this is JSON, and you just substitute the little brackets for the funky characters that are in there, and it's, yeah.
How do you like JSON versus like XML, because XML is more verbose. Is there any real preference that you...
No, JSON is the only way. JSON and plain old XML are the only way to go. If you get with SOAP-based stuff that's got extra, this is just, it only delivers data. It's not interested in anything else. So I'm interested in anything that will only deliver data. This and plain old XML are the only two things that really are very efficient.
Right, but do you have a preference for one or the other?
JSON is a little easier to deal with when you find for third-party clients, and there's just better things out there to deal with it, I think. I ended up using a Microsoft one when I was serializing and deserializing this.
Are you currently consulting for
HTML? No. No, and what I'm going to show you is not the code that I checked into their production. In fact, no, I am not. This is complete pretend data. But this is what plain old XML looks like, and if we were to compare those two things that I showed you, you would see that the only difference are the delimiters are slightly different. There's the same number of characters exactly. RESTful is useful when you have different clients. It's used for Atom Publishing, the Amazon.com's S3 e-commerce developer interface, eBay, Facebook, Twitter, everybody that's anybody on the web uses RESTful services. And you may someday end up writing something that consumes the service, which is easy, but I had to also create one that a .NET that published out too. So that was the fun part. It's simpler is the reason why everybody uses it. It's about as dead simple as you can get. The hard part is, since .NET is very SOAP-centric, it was actually harder to write a RESTful service than you'd think. However, there is something called the RESTful Toolkit for .NET 3.5. It is truly RESTful. It's not just saying that it's RESTful, which is to say that service doesn't sit there and run in the background. That would not be RESTful. RESTful is, it's sitting there waiting for something to hit it, and then it comes alive. The .NET toolkit is not necessarily thread safe. It's very poorly documented, and there's a lot of references that you have to add. But if you download the thing that is on my site, you don't have to worry about that. I was able to transfer this onto any computer and get it to work just fine in Visual Studio. During my research, in case anybody knows anything about this, there are other ways to do RESTful services in .NET. And as part of my research, of course, I already said that I tried to go with a WCF SOAP based, and the programmers on the Java side just said no. And they'll all say that. There's a way to do it in Entity Framework for .NET 4.0. The problem with that was basically the unfamiliarity that I had with Entity Framework. And I know some of you guys at Horace Mann are using that, right? A lot. And you might have gone this route instead. The problem I was having, and I had another person helping me, neither one of us could figure out how to get Entity Framework to interface with our stored procedures. So not that it mattered where the data was coming from, but as soon as you went off the stopped with your select statements and started doing something else, a little bit, just slightly more complicated, we couldn't figure it out. And we were not idiots, so I don't know what the deal was with that. So we ended up abandoning the Entity Framework, but I think that it's worth visiting again. It's a possibility, because it does a lot of stuff for you. That's just a criticism of .NET web services. .NET web services are only .NET, and WCF services might as well be. Because no one else will use them. One of the things that I have, since I've written both WCF SOAP-based services and RESTful services, one of the things I have discovered is that you do have to keep your data very simple. I think you saw earlier the JSON data. It was just things in quote, just data in quotes. And it's pretty important that you not use any sophisticated types. If you're going to use some really complicated type, just pass it as a string and let the other side deal with the information. That's how they do it when they're doing e-commerce sites. They'll just give you, here's the price, you know, it's a string, figure it out. When I was writing the Java-based services, you can put it up in a Tomcat server and so forth. It's easy to set up. And quite frankly, if you have an opportunity to learn how to do that, it's incredibly simple. And it's not something that a .NET programmer would have any difficulty doing. It was more difficult to install Eclipse than it was to get the programs running. I already explained that there's a steep learning curve on any framework. So the RESTful toolkit provides all the RESTful samples you want. And when I opened this thing up for the first time, I think it had 8 or 9 different projects in it. And I didn't know what any of them were. And when I started running them, they all crashed. And I had to figure out why. It took me about a day to get them all running. And the purpose of this talk is really to show you what could be done with it. There's all the references, by the way, that I found when I opened this thing up. You can see that there's just an awful lot of weird-looking things in there. There's dealing with service models and enterprise services, and just there was a lot of extra junk in there that you don't normally see. And I think I already alluded to the fact that JSON and plain old XML are logically equivalent. And the service.
JSON was better. I'm sorry.
I was using 3. The JSON that came with Microsoft. And I think I'll actually get into that when I bust into the code and start talking about it, because it'll be a part of the include file.
Is it easier if you have the JSON if you're dealing with something like using JavaScript or something?
Yeah. The guys that I was doing for my previous client was software architecting, proof of concepts. The other team ended up going off and they're still working on that project. They were using a lot of what you say with JavaScript and so forth, and they were using JSON for it. It is much easier to deal with JSON.
It's actually one line. There's about parts.
Yeah.
And then you have an XML view, or you have JavaScript.
Yeah, it's super, super easy. Like, the reason that this is so popular is because it's drop-dead simple. Everywhere except it's just a JavaScript thing, right? And everybody, JavaScript runs in anything, so any web browser, so you're fine. And I'm sure jQuery handles it just as well. So, in fact, do you do jQuery? Yeah. That's what I would do. Probably the best thing to do at this point is to get into some code. Contract. Okay. So what I'm going to show you right now is my account dispatch. So this is the .NET, not the consumer, but the producer of the. So this was derived from the .NET RESTful toolkit. It's just, there's a lot of different things in there. I'm not going to deal with the RSS feeds because I didn't need that. I just needed to be able to go get some data and bring it back, kind of like you would if you were calling the database, essentially. So as I showed earlier, there's a lot of references in there, and they just take care of it for you. And there's a service. This is a netbook I'm running on. Can you believe that? And it's somehow managing to run all this stuff on it. And all this code was taken from their model. And all it really is doing is presenting some contracts. And here's one for getting plain old XML. And you pass it a user ID, which would be, you know, whatever. And here's the one for JSON, which I ended up using. And there's not much to it. There's a lot of magic, though. You can see that, you know, this is a magic contract. It's doing a web get here. It's got your operation contract, and then you're passing in a thing of type account. This actually was a real-world example when it was hooked up to the real database for our client. It was just the name and the number. That's all it was. It was a drop-down. We actually made it work. So it was, as a proof of concept, it was a little bit more realistic than most. And then you just go and get your data. So you say, well, I want to go get my data. And I had to fake this data in, so this used to be hooked up to a database, and I've overridden that with this. So I'm just faking data in with a data table. And it's just going and getting some values. let me go back to my... Great. So we got to talk about the operation contract, the data itself. Opened up the, okay. So the JSON example, and I think we already looked at this, just the account fetcher, it's really, there's nothing much to it. But essentially all this is doing is just acting as a database and presenting the data back. The account.
So the JSON conversion is just done automatically?
Well, it's not even done. You don't even deal with it in the part that I've already showed you, which is the dispatcher that sends the data out. There's nothing. It just does it for you. I think.
Can you go back to that code?
I will. I'm gonna. Yeah, I was just thinking I should do that. Hold on a sec. So, part of the magic of this thing is that there's some references that make this all possible, and I just told it that I wanted it to be JSON. And it is. And I think right here is where it is. See right there? That's the magic. And the whole point is that it's this easy in Java world and Ruby on Rails and everybody else. It's all this simple. And so the whole point of this toolkit that they wrote was, don't worry about all the JSON stuff. Just set a variable and it does it for you. So the only issue is when you're consuming it on the other side, you will have to have the serializer, deserializer, of course.
You know, if it goes, I'm just wondering on the cover, do you know when it goes to serialize this, does it start with the class structure and directly into JSON, or does it actually, I'm assuming the default response format is
XML. Yep, it sure is.
Class is that you have.
That's right. In fact, see on the other one up above that was plain old XML, I didn't have to say anything there.
Yeah.
So, but with the with JSON, I did have to.
No, but even at the class level where mm-hmm. you want to go to XML, sometimes you'll want to go in and override certain attributes.
Yeah. Yeah, it's one of those .NET biases towards XML, and the rest of the industry is biased towards JSON. That's just the way it is. So you have to set.
If you had gone into a class and say you were going to handle both, if you wanted to control the XML format, would those attributes at the class level mess with the JSON serialization? And I'm not trying to stump. I'm just interested more of if JSON is an add-on, is it going to first go to XML and then to JSON?
Oh.
You know what I mean?
I don't know how this thing works on the inside. And that's the whole point of it, is that you're not supposed to. So I don't know the answer. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and they're both Microsoft references.
When you had the ability to,
you know what? I never had to tweak. Mm-hmm. I'm guessing that you would.
I just know in XML, you quite often do because you don't always get to work with nice, cute little objects, you know, little classes. Yeah. Things get complicated quick. Mm-hmm. So then, even in XML serialization, you want to get in and fiddle with it sometimes. Not often, but it happens.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I ask one more?
Sure, no.
Since we've interrupted. You can consume this then with almost any system, but is
you
this
can resist
that is IIS specific then?
No. There's no IIS. That's what makes it so much radically different from SOAP.
So you can actually dump this onto
I did so. And it was very easy, and that's the whole point.
So
just like an RSS feed, you can hit it from anything, anywhere. You can go get the data and
right, but I guess the thing is the server-side code. Is that?
The server-side code.
The
server-side code in .NET obviously is going to have to run in a .NET context. I see what you're saying. I'm sorry.
Yes,
I was
probably an IIS server, but then
sure. And ideally, as I mentioned earlier, you wouldn't even write this in .NET, not the dispatcher. But if you don't know any other language, it can be done. And it's not all that hard with the toolkit, and the entity framework's another option as well. Yeah. I wanted to make a point, and this is probably not even worth mentioning, but since I'm running ahead, the way that I did this in terms of arrays of objects being returned. So there's an account object, and the way this fetcher worked is we just used a collection. This was just to overcome the fact that you don't know how many items you're going to get back. So you do it as a collection. You go get your data. Now in here, normally you would just be getting data from the database. I'm going to go get a data table instead. And then at the very end, when I return it, I'm going to return it back as an array. So it's expecting an array of accounts. So that's no magic there. That's not even very challenging, but just something to point out. Go right ahead.
I'm not a WCF user. I thought like when Microsoft came out with WCF, all the hype Microsoft put around it was the whole, oh, we can swap the transport layer, and you know, we can do one configuration change, not touch the code, now you're, you know, binary, or now you're XML.
Yeah.
It seems to me like with this toolkit, you're kind of getting away, that promise is kind of being abandoned.
Yeah.
I feel like left behind with Microsoft, I would look at this, shouldn't it just be another setting you can change them?
Well, and I looked into that. I think I must have fought with that particular approach for about a day and a half or two, trying to get something to work through WCF and setting it and so that it would return, you know, JSON that way. I tried it, and there's a lot of problems with it, and a lot of people inside Microsoft realized that too, that it was just not really working. And it seems like that's when, besides the fact that if I had got it working, it wouldn't really be RESTful. It would have to be an active system, you know. It's really SOAP based, spoofing out as if it's RESTful anyway, and that's not really the way it works.
Well, so it really seems like it's RESTful here to me, and this is the first time I've seen it. So
yeah,
my experience as well, but it's a combination of the threading model of bringing it to life and the format that the data's gonna come back in.
Right. Yeah, and there. And by the way, that brings up that makes me think of an issue that some people mentioned is what happens if you've got hundreds of people hitting your Twitter, and you've got that coming back. I'm sure there are some issues with your hardware and software configuration to deal with how you might have to distribute that across multiple, I don't know, server or instances or something in order to get that to work. You know, how many can it handle per second? I don't know. But there are issues like that have obviously been conquered. I don't know if they've been conquered in .NET. I'm pretty sure most of these people have written them in some other.
Well, I don't know with the newer version of IIS, but the older one, they use IO completion ports. So you just have your listener block down at the hardware level.
Yeah.
So it would be in kernel waiting. So that you weren't paying any other time.
So you keep stressing that point of RESTful. Let me make sure I understand this correctly. You're saying that be truly RESTful, it's got to view up a whole new object, and you can deal with that request, and then it gets destroyed like off the heap. So
that's the way I understand that it works.
Why is that so important to be
lower overhead? I know that sounds strange, but it's very simple. There's not much that can go wrong. It doesn't take much to get the thing to run. It just runs, and I think in the entity framework, it even runs better. From what we could do, we could tell with the research, it's just that we couldn't get it working.
So that's interesting. So there's like more performance, you're saying? And
there really is. Let me see.
That kind of goes contrary to like the stuff they did, connection pooling and the whole logic.
Well, you can look it up, and I'm no expert in the guts of the thing. Let me see. There's a couple of interesting things I'm going to show you since we're doing really well for time. I'm going to go ahead and run this in the browser. Let's see if I can find this thing. It's probably time to start looking at the results of the code anyway. So this is the service itself. When it comes up and you call it, the first thing it says, well, I don't know what's going on. But since it is truly RESTful, part of a truly RESTful solution, and this does work in Entity Framework as well, is it'll give you a service help page and you go to the service help page, and it kind of tells you how to call it. And this is typical of anything I've seen really in REST, is that it'll tell you, well, if you want to call get account plain old XML or get account JSON, this is how you call it. And it gives me the URL right there. And so if I copy and paste this in, now I'm obviously faking the ID on that. Let's see, is that running? So that should come up here in a second. Oh, okay, so this wants me to save. All right, so this is gonna save because it's JSON. View the download. All right. I don't know. Open it in anything. There it is. So it's a little friendlier when you're doing it with plain old XML because a browsers know what to do with plain old XML. If I change this to POX, my problem is I don't know how to deserialize it quite as easily on the other end. But this is, you know, you've seen that a million times. There's the data that we just downloaded in the other way. When I want to actually go ahead and get that data, I'm going to write my deserializer, which is, this could be anything. It happens to be written in .NET, but the whole point was that you could do this in Ruby or whatever. So I wrote a RESTful service, and I don't see the JSON deserializer reference, unfortunately, in here anywhere. But there it is. This is a Microsoft thing, and I seem to have lost my references, so I don't see that anywhere. But there's a lot of stuff in here, but that's the only one that really mattered was that. So when you give me a sec here. Okay. So if I paste this in here and I say get, it goes and gets the data in JSON. And how it does that is really incredibly simple. Let me make sure I've got the right thing. Sorry, there's a million things running on this little thing. It's going to take a second. There we go. So it clicks button click one, and it just opens up a URL that's in the text box. It says, well, let's do a web request to the URL and do a get, and we're going to set JSON as the type. And then we're going to open up a stream reader and go ahead and get the response stream. And that's pretty much it. Nope, there's no connected web reference anywhere, and that's kind of a new deal.
This is like really low level. I just want to see.
Yeah, but it's super easy to deal with this data because now it's true that somewhere in this code, I did recreate my account that we knew on the other end, and it certainly. I don't know if that's cheating or not, but I certainly found it very easy, much easier to do it that way. And since you know what kind of data you're going to get back, I'm sure they have specifications for all these various feeds that you can get. You can just say, well, this is what I'm expecting. So I'm going to go get one of those.
So you're just going to serialize into a completely different.
I'm just going to serialize that right into my data grid.
I think that
Duh.
Is cheating, by the way.
What?
I think that is cheating, by the way.
Probably cheating. And I cheated, but the big man upstairs needed to see it really work. You know, they're very visual people. So this is if you click the button, the deserialize button, it does the same thing, but it also at the very end goes ahead and says, well, here's a collection of accounts, which looks awfully familiar. I think we've seen that code before. And then it goes into a little loop and here's the data contract serializer right there that I was talking about. And we played around with various ones that were third-party clients, and you know what? The Microsoft one works better. So I wouldn't mess with anything else. I'm pretty sure that'll work in 4.0 as well if you want to do that. A lot of the, it's funny because the third-party ones, it's they have problems with compatibility for some reason. And so you get these funky errors with illegal characters. And JSON's so simple, I don't know why they can't do it. But anyway, Microsoft did it. It works just fine. So this is where I'm just binding it. And the only thing I had to do is just make sure, you know, and put it into a thing of type account, and this thing is going to render account just as it doesn't really care that it's not coming from a web service. Technically speaking, it really is coming from a web service, but it's coming from one that's completely agnostic. It doesn't, it's not a .NET one. And it's quite easy to do this. Now where it gets a little tricky is if you start having to do things that are more complicated than just selecting. That was a select. Now I've stubbed out somewhere in here, probably in my service, that you can do other things as well. And I did not test them, I did not have time, but you could add an account with JSON or with plain old XML. You could delete. Now deleting would be easy. You just say delete this ID, and it goes in and it deletes it. And it probably sends you a little message back and says, yep, I deleted it. But that's about as easy as it gets. It's debatable whether inserting is the best way to do it is this way. It depends on how much data. If you're uploading an image through JSON or through this kind of method, I'm a little fuzzy on what the limits are on that.
Do you have ability to dictate the encoding as well?
That's probably the answer to the, if you do, then you should be able to handle that, yeah. So you can just get and post. Yeah, it's CRUD. It's CRUD. It's a create and update, and you're using a different standard. I would think so. Yeah, and I did not have time to delve into this. The deletes drop dead simple, and the updates fairly simple too.
I saw your example for dealing with that account object. Would it introduce any more complexity if, let's say, you have an items class and list a collection of items underneath that account that you have?
If you can deal with, as long as everything's a string, and you want to do basically a double array, right? You're going to have some things with other things inside of it, right?
A class that might have an array.
Yeah, I never actually tried that because that would probably defeat the purpose of one of talks like these or my proof of concept. But yeah, I think as long as you can deserialize it properly, that's the key. I'm certain you could send the data out.
So if you can't deserialize it using that tricky data, you're left with a string and figure it out.
Yeah. But as you saw, all you have to do is have the same definition on one side as you did on the other. You may be dealing with a client though that where you're getting the data from some service, some Amazon.com or something.
On your help page, it had like a wistful like layout, and it also looked like it referenced that you could, in addition to getting the operation signature, contract signature, you can get the schema.
Yep, sure can. There it is. Let me get the schema that I'm interested in for JSON.
Yep.
I didn't dig into this very far because there was not a lot of money in digging into this since I got it working so easily. But I don't even know if it's doing anything. There you go. So this is not the kind of stuff that it will actually send across the wire, by the way.
No, but I'm wondering.
Yep.
If there are code accelerators for writing a .NET client against a JSON service, to where you point to it, you know it does all that with the SOAP stuff and WCF.
It does, and it's very SOAP-centric, right?
If it can serve this kind of schema and then help you,
so you're talking about the serializer, basically the consumer, right? Now that I don't know, because the RESTful toolkit is, of course, delivering the data. I don't know of any special helpers other than just the JSON, and obviously you could use an XML deserializer for consuming it.
Yeah, with XML being the output, you can pretty much figure it out by looking at it. And that way you can kind of keep some strongly typed data, you know, going across.
Yeah.
But you think it has to do a little work working with the dictionary.
Yeah. There was, I clicked on example and it threw me out some example JSON just so you could see it. Yeah, but this is all produced by their little RESTful toolkit, so you don't have to deal with it yourself.
Good.
Which is super good. Entity Framework does the same thing, maybe even better, so which is nice, but I'm not sure if Entity Framework is production worthy at this point for that kind of stuff. It looks like it's a toy to me, but maybe that's just the way I'm looking at it. If somebody really knew what they were doing with Entity Framework, I have a feeling you could do the same thing.
Okay. Entity can go through a service level with things like Silverlight has to do that.
Yeah.
You can build proxies automatically, and then the things you're having a hard WCF behind the scenes.
Right.
I don't know what they're doing with JSON kinds of things, because the thing is, One question that I was going to ask you near the end, and you can defer this, is, you know, what are some of the issues with security and things?
Oh, yeah, security. Well, most of these services want you to call them because they're trying to sell something. So that's probably what they're used for the most part. And if you're an entity and you're trying to make your service available, even if you're just talking to other parts of your own company and you're using this, I think...
Right. I guess what I'm saying is you never use this with something like a medical records.
On an intranet, you could, obviously.
Intranet, yeah.
Intranet, but extra... That's a great question that would require a lot of thought.
Well, yeah. Different TPP, so you can do that over a secure socket layer.
Right, and you'd have to do like
do it at the transport level.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where that would go in the place.
I would imagine it's been done.
Yeah, and again, if it's just a layer, then the code doesn't do a difference. It's just the communication.
Yeah. Security seems to be running outside of a lot of software that people write these days anyway.
It's a good thing. You can put it in, you can take it out.
And the developer doesn't know the difference. So you're certainly not having to fight with IIS too much at this level.
The transport's a big part of what WCF brags about.
But does that, even if it's HTTPS, is that, I might be ignorant here, but is that protecting everything, like including like the query? Like for example, let's say, I'm not going to name any names, but let's say we had a database that was driven by social security number because it's written wrong, let's just assume. So your delete method there was actually, you know, you'd have to put like that social as part of that query string. Mm-hmm. Is that, that query string data, is that protected over SSL and SSL?
You can do a post rather than get.
Yeah. Yeah, you can, and I didn't put that part of into this particular presentation because it turned out to be, they'd kind of hide it from you a little bit with this. But yeah, if you get down deep enough, you'll get the posts and the gets, and you have to be careful about what you're doing. The RESTful toolkit just kind of says, I'll take care of it for you. And I think Entity Framework hides it even better. Yeah. Otherwise, you're going to get yourself all snarled up and... things that really don't matter that much. Just get me the data. That's all I want. So let me see. To summarize, we went ahead and went with JSON because that does seem to be an industry standard. Didn't look into too much Entity Framework, but it could be done. You've got the data. You've got the RESTful toolkit on one side that's doing a lot of work for you. All you have to do is have a serializer, deserializer on the other end, and you've got your data. And you can put it into any object you want, any drop down, any grid, whatever you want. And there's no web service being added to the .NET project. It just goes and gets it. It's all the REST needs is the URL, and that's why I use that example, because it really, that's all there is to it. It's literally, that's it.
One silly question that I would have is, for things like Silverlight, every once in a while, versioning when you're doing code updates can be a real pain in the tail, because what's happening is you have browser caching, and then, you know, the server updating and everything else, and forcing it to do an update when you expect. I'm thinking more from a development standpoint.
Right.
Did you ever run across this in some of the work you were doing? If, like, for example, I had to keep putting version strings a lot of times in the app just as a confirmation to make sure my changes were being all the way flushed through.
Oh, yeah.
So did you ever see that?
My understanding is the way you solve that is by having them at different addresses.
Yes.
That would be the way to do it. You don't mess around with something that's handling more than one thing at the same time.
Well, not at the same time, but during development when you're iterating through
it. Oh, when you're iterating through it?
It's stuck and you're seeing an old version and you're trying to diagnose what's happening or make changes. This is development only. Deployment.
Yeah, you can write yourself into a corner if you make things too complicated for yourself. My only advice is to try to keep them separate.
Yeah, but this probably would have some of the same issues.
It would have the same issues as anything, and you solve that with different URLs. And that would be the thing to do, and just you could literally name the URL after your version number.
Yeah, well, that's one of the common tricks that's often done.
Yeah.
And again, because it just forces, you know, browser update.
Right. Is there anybody hasn't talked that wants to talk? I can see this is a lot more interesting than I thought it was when I brought it up to Alan. I didn't realize how different this was. So,
but it is interesting because often we get stuck in the tools we're used to. You know, like I've done WCF, yeah. WCF, and again, the Java world does it differently. And I didn't expect it to be as different.
Right, it's kind of different. It's back to your basic programming. There's not as many tools involved, but for the most part, most .NET programmers all are only dealing with the serializer part. They're receiving it from somebody like Amazon or eBay or somebody. So all you have to do is be able to deal with the data. But if you have to produce the data, there's a couple of different solutions.
Now having served a bath 4 months on the Forest Man fence, and then prior to that at the LRS fence, my opinion is, if you're going for interoperability, you're a service writer. You're trying to write a web service, and you got to have support interoperability. From what I had experience with LRS and what I see a lot of going on with Forkman, a lot of their other assets are .NET, so they're going to be looking at doing a .NET service.
Centric service, right, which works.
So that they can use all the other assets and
that's right.
We do there.
That's right.
And that's the...
And it connects well.
And it connects well. And it only talks to... Yes, right.
Like we're talking about
right.
mobile apps.
Right.
You know, that's,
well, now, as soon as you start doing mobile apps, then you're starting to get more into the area of where it's not really, you know, you don't know exactly what's consuming it now. That's in the moving into the future. .NET is.
If your percentage is remotely right, that yeah. means that it's going to continue to every Tom, Dick, and Harry is going to support.
That's right.
This format, so we need to serve this.
So if Horace Mann starts making little apps for people's phone and they're sitting there hitting that thing, it's going to have to be available out there and handle whatever protocol that darn thing takes,
yeah.
which is going to be this, probably.
Well, you said Microsoft advertised that it could do this, it just fell short in the actual...
Yeah, that's why the RESTful toolkit was created.
Is it reasonable to assume that they'll get their act together and fix whatever issues they're having with the WCF implementation so it actually works appropriately at some point?
No, they didn't.
Not his client code, but his server code for .NET, that wasn't that gnarly. I mean, right. That's done through attributes, right?
But see, the other thing is if Entity can do this, Entity can push out standard SOAP kind of things in the standard WCF
sure.
way really, really fast.
Right, and then you can switch. You can just switch.
You would have a dual-headed. I mean, you're
right.
not going to go and convert from one to the next and have multi-threads and things.
There like are ways, and I forgot to mention that in my research, there are ways to do all of this stuff in various forms to switch around.
You can have like two address heads where, you know, you go through the Microsoft
right.
side or you go through the RESTful side
right.
and just have two address points, but they're hitting the same database.
Yep.
In fact,
they're probably
that,
calling the same database call.
Yeah. But I think that sounds like what they're doing, but
yeah.
I haven't seen the code, so that's a guess on a guess.
Yeah. No, that's probably how it works. So, it's pretty cool.
The REST toolkit is actually a dead project.
It is actually considered dead, yeah.
But it's now incorporated in version 4.
You can use it in version 4.
Did they kill it because of Entity, or is there a different reason?
I think they killed it because they decided to pull it in. To ran it in, it's native.
Yeah, it's native now, right. And I haven't seen that, but and it might be the Entity is where they pulled it into. I don't know. It's pretty interesting, but the learning curve's a little steep, as everyone who's dealt with Entity knows. You got to really get into that stuff. That's all I had to say. I wish I knew how the exact guts of the thing work. I thought it'd be nice if everybody knew that this was possible, and it's pretty darn easy.
This is good, though, for a talk, because it gives a different context for things that sometimes we haven't thought about.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, this gives you some options when SOAP's not going to work, or somebody says, well, we got to talk to these people over in China, and they don't care. They're just open source people.
Yeah, interoperability.
Yep. Yep. I got it in under an hour.